Okay, in this week, August 12 to 20, here in the Philippines, the one issue that cropped up was the observation highlighted by a few of the mainstream media, such as the Inquirer, of Congressman Gary Alejano's shrill call for the Philippines to react to the presence allegedly of Chinese vessels seen near Pag-asa Island. Here are some of the images from there. But photographs from the Magdalo Party List group claim that five Chinese vessels were seen near Pag-asa Island, which is occupied by the country in the disputed South China Sea since August 15. Magdalo Representative Gary Alejano said Tuesday that his sources inside the military said China deployed two frigates, one Coast Guard vessel, and two large fishing vessels along with militia since August 12, 2 to 5 nautical miles away from the island. Pag-asa Island is within the 200 nautical mile exclusive economic zone of the Philippines. It is the seat of the Calayan Municipal Government and under the province of Palawan. It is part of the Calayan Island Group, which the country occupied in the South China Sea. And so, we also got the reaction from Cayetano, and this is the headline among the many reports of Cayetano's comments. Cayetano downplays presence of Chinese vessels, militia near Pag-asa Island. Cayetano said the presence of Chinese ships could just form part of freedom of navigation being enjoyed not just by China but even the country's key ally, the United States. Cayetano, however, did not confirm that such ships and militia were spotted near Pag-asa Island. The presence of ships alone does not mean anything. Let me ask Congressman Alejano, why are we not concerned with the U.S. doing freedom of navigation? Ang lalaki ng ships nila, they have very big ships. You know why? Because they are allies, unquote, Cayetano added. Cayetano said the situation in Pag-asa Island remains stable. If we keep looking at China as the enemy, this is attributed to Cayetano, every time may movement sila, masyado tayong nagre-react. Every time they have, in English, they have a movement, we are exaggerating our reaction. It's good we have people like Congressman Alejano who reminds us to monitor the situation, but there's a thin line between informing us and stirring up the situation, Cayetano said. There is no situation there that is a cause of lowering mutual trust between all of the claimants at this point in time, he added. For his part, Philippine Coast Guard Commodore Joel Garcia, whom we have interviewed once before in the show Journeys, said the Chinese vessels may just be practicing freedom of navigation, which does not constitute a violation of international law. And so we have other items highlighting the reaction of our Foreign Affairs Secretary Cayetano. So, Ado, any reaction to this?
Well, I am encouraging Congressman Cayetano to grow up. He is looking at the situation from the narrow end of the funnel. And this is dangerous, dangerous speak in diplomacy. I am not surprised that he is. He is a soldier, former soldier, maybe even a PMA graduate.
He is a PMA graduate.
Still a PMA graduate. And you know, the doctrines that we still have in the old curriculum of the Philippine Military Academy is very much American. Mm. And so, and this can easily evolve into xenophobia.
Mm.
And I will not take anything about Mr. Alejano seriously, yeah, because it has become, it has reached the level of bigotry on his part. Mm. Maybe because he's in the minority. If he speaks in the voice of the minority might just be whittled down.
Mm.
And they seem to have lost the trust anymore of the Filipino people because they seem to just represent their own vested interests.
Of course, Congressman Alejano, I'm sure, is fashioning himself as part of the opposition and therefore exercising a critical perspective on all these
part
issues.
Of the irresponsible opposition.
Okay. Do you have any reaction to this? I know you're not in the field of politics and the foreign policy, Arlyne, but you may have, as an educator and a citizen, some reaction to this.
Yeah, actually, though I'm not in a, you know, I don't have any much background about politics, but my 3 years in Beijing, I only watched one English channel, the CGTN, and it's all about you know, politics, environment, mm-hmm. culture across the globe.
Mm-hmm.
So for me, that's why I'm somehow you know, updated with the global mm-hmm. news, what's happening
yes.
there and here.
Yes.
So for me, that's why I'm trying to promote the critical media literacy. Mm-hmm. And then though we acknowledge very much here the freedom mm-hmm. of speech and uh-huh. democracy uh-huh. that we are always, you know, pushing. But then at the end of the day, we must be critical and to strike a balance.
Mm-hmm.
It's though we have all our personal biases, mm-hmm. but we just try to minimize it and mm-hmm. set aside and look at the bigger perspective.
Okay.
Yeah.
Yeah. In the interest of balance and perspective, we present some past factual reports. For example, this item where the American ship found itself aground at Tubataha Reef. Do we have that item there? U.S. Navy ship runs aground in Tubataha and damaged the reef, and the Philippines filed a protest, but only after they hit aground in Tubataha. So the American ships have been plying not only within territorial waters, but within internal waters that the Philippines consider its internal territorial waters, in between the islands of the Philippines. That's why they were on the eastern side of Palawan, which is part of the internal waters, and not the eastern part of Palawan, and not the western side of Palawan. And the fact is, this is what the Americans do also with regards to the Chinese territorial seas. China, for example, in this item, U.S. warship sails within 12 miles of China-claimed reef, followed by a more important news item, which is the Americans reporting themselves the freedom of navigation that the U.S. exercises is not only with China, but U.S. Navy ships challenged territorial claims of 21 other countries last year in 2016. This report came out March 6, 2017. The U.S. Military conducted freedom of navigation operations to challenge the territorial claims of 22 countries in fiscal year 2016, according to a report released Monday. The most publicized of those operations took place in the South China Sea. Of course, that's always the most publicized, where the Navy challenged China's claims to man-made islands in the body of water, and where other countries also claim territory. Quote, "I know a lot of people, when they talk about freedom of navigation operations, immediately jump to China. This is not about China. This is about the entire world and preserving freedom of navigation with set standard of international law for the entire global commons," Navy Captain Jeff Davis said Monday. "You will see names on this report of friends and allies. Brazil, Japan, Malaysia, the Philippines, South Korea, Thailand are among the countries that have excessive claims that we have challenged." That is what they say, excessive claims. But that, of course, that is not what these countries believe. Accession to the UN Convention. This is another item that is important for Filipinos to understand. On the Convention on the Law of the Sea is unnecessary, according to this paper, to secure U.S. navigational rights and freedom. This is from the Heritage Foundation. This is a report by Stephen Groves Bernard and Barbara Lomas, Senior Research Fellow. Stephen worked to protect and preserve American sovereignty, self-governance, and independence as a former leader of the Freedom Project. This accession is very long. This commentary is very long. But basically, the message to the American legislature is they don't need to join the UNCLOS. So why are they interfering in this region? Well, anyway, so this is the focus we have. And You have your analysis, Ado, Mr. Paglinawan. Anything more to add?
Well, this is just in the tail end of an aborted campaign of the United States to shame China in the South China Sea. And unfortunately, the Aquino administration from 2010 to 2016 allowed itself to proxy for this kind of bigoted thinking by unilaterally seeking a decision, an ill-founded decision from the Permanent Court of Arbitration. Now, which is not a human, which is not a UN body. The UN has disclaimed that the PCA is a UN body and that the similarity only extends insofar as the PCA occupies a building in The Hague where the International Court of Justice is also located. But basically, the PCA, and this is why it's ill-founded, cannot even enforce its own decisions. In an arbitration, the operative word here, permanent court arbitration, it involves, arbitration necessarily involves at least two countries disputing and bringing it to a third party for a third opinion, which hopefully the two parties or more in dispute could implement among themselves and not rely on any compulsory enforcement. It is unfortunate, really, that the case that we had with the Permanent Court of Arbitration was only with the Philippines as the petitioner and the referee inside the ring. So how can there be an arbitration?
China did not
participate, and China could not participate because it could not harmonize with its own domestic laws. And the UNCLOS allows, in cases like that, when countries cannot harmonize their own domestic laws with UNCLOS, to make declarations during the signing, upon ratification, and any time thereafter. And China did theirs upon ratification, insofar as sovereignty issues are concerned, and in 2006, any time thereafter, insofar as submitting itself to any compulsory arbitration, signifying that it will deal with any country in dispute with itself only through bilateral talks. So when the United States, through the Philippine proxy, brought this to the Permanent Court of Arbitration, it was doomed from the very beginning. And so when they now have this award, and this is what sticks into Cayetano's mind, and up to now they're still insisting. Congressman Alejano's mind. And to this day, it's still existing. In the words of Albert del Rosario, Institute of Strategic Studies, in the words of its talking heads, Associate Justice Carpio and Roelio Goles, and in the articles of the Philippine Star and the Philippines Daily Inquirer and ABS-CBN, in the columns of Jarius Bundok and Frederick Pascual, it's still circulating in media. This is fake news. This is not only fake news, but disinformation.
Okay, well,
disinformation. They are deliberately misleading the public to go back to a old way of thinking that is no, that was never valid, that was never legally binding, and could be dangerous to the relationship of the states involved in the South China Sea.
Okay, that sums up the views that Ambassador Ado Paglinawan has written about, which is being circulated in Facebook. Anything to add, Madam?
So far, I think it's about time for us to think as a nation and not just to think of our just personal interests, as what Sir said. It's not about minority and majority and the opposition and the administration. For me, from the educator's perspective, we need to think beyond that kind of you know, line of thinking, because we are now working not just for today but for our future generation. How can we make things sustainable if we our own selves as a country cannot, you know, stand on our what we believe in as a nation and just to create our own identity as a Filipino? So I think it's about time to start it, and I hope I can do my share as educator to have this kind of sustainable goal, not just for the, you know, knowledge, but this kind of critical media literacy, environmental sustainability. I hope I can do my part.
Mabuhay. Thank you. Arlyne Marasigan, doctor, graduate from Beijing Normal University. Maraming salamat po. And let's get on with the next week, and we'll report to you again.